R&B star R. Kelly had a long history of allegations of sexual misconduct. In his autobiography, he discussed his own history of being sexually abused as a child. As Kelly was being sued over an accusation of sexual assault, Lifetime Television recently released a documentary highlighting multiple accusers, painting a very dark picture of Kelly.
I was a little girl in like a bad man's world. I never really recovered from it.
Kelly's lawyer responded, saying these allegations are untrue. Let's bring in our A-plus panel to break this down. We're joined by Lisa Durden, social commentator. Good to see you, Lisa.
Of course.
And Bob Bianchi, defense attorney and former prosecutor. Good to see you, Bob.
Good to see you, Bill.
All right, Lisa, I'm going to start with you on this. In the R&B industry, in a lot of the minds of a lot of people, this is an iconic guy in music. What do you say about all of a sudden now you've got accusations coming up from years and years ago? He's had a reputation literally over decades for some bad behavior, even to the point where he was acquitted of child porn charges.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's not all of a sudden. People don't understand that documentary Surviving R. Kelly on Lifetime, the executive producer, Dream Hampton, has been working on this for over 20 years because these accusations have been happening over time and no one was collecting it. Now, these alleged charges about child rape in the studio, the infamous video with the 14-year-old girl, he was urinating on the girl and in her mouth as well. And currently, there are four women in his house that they claim have been abducted. Their families are looking for them.
Bob, we've gone from social media accusations to now you've got an actual monetized documentary and there have been no charges. I mean, other than old charges.
Yeah, well, you know, given that Lifetime is a pretty major outfit with a team and slew of attorneys, I am absolutely confident that those lawyers felt at least
they vetted it.
These reports and the vetting of the data would not trigger the slander laws. But again, if you're a public figure, it's very difficult to be found responsible for slandering a public figure. But those lawyers were going to be pretty paranoid that the stuff is at least well-sourced in my mind.
You know, we're hearing this again and again, allegations that are very, very dated. Allegations that come back sometimes 20 years later. Are we doing more harm than good to our system by throwing this out? Because in the court of public opinion, in the eyes of many people, he's going to be guilty whether there's a trial or not.
In the past, people are going to disagree with this, okay, but just hear me out. It used to be that you would try the case of the specific victim in that case. You wouldn't bring in two decades worth of people to come in. It used to be banned, but now they allow that to happen. And as you see what happened in Cosby, the first case was a mistrial. The prosecutor asked the judge to put five or six more women in.
Because you had so many accusers.
So eventually it gets to a point that if you're rich and you're famous, let's just presume for the sake of argument you're innocent. Well, if you pile on 50 or 60 people to talk about what a dirtbag you are, you're going to get convicted.
So I guess that's the point. If they lower the threshold of what constitutes guilty beyond a reasonable doubt.
Absolutely. In today's environment, it's assassination by bad character evidence, which under the law used to not be allowed.
All right. Thanks, guys.